When Mount Pinatubo in the Philippines erupted with such catastrophic force in 1991, Typhoon Yunya hit almost simultaneously. During that time, many observers thought, how unlucky could this country be? But what if we told you that this typhoon actually saved the world from a more serious disaster? Now, before you quickly scratch your head in disbelief, let's get back in time first when it happened. Mount Pinatubo is an active volcano located in the Zambales Mountains on the northern island of Luzon. Before its major eruption in June 1991, signs of activity first appeared on April 2nd, with small steam explosions. In the weeks that followed, earthquakes shook the area intermittently, their frequency changing without warning. Until that day, scientists regarded Pinatubo as a quiet volcano that had last been active sometime within the past 1,000 years. It had even been considered for geothermal energy development, but the project never moved forward. The mountain was covered in thick jungle, and for generations, it had been home to the indigenous Ida people. They lived off the land, moving through the forests that had long provided them with food and shelter. Meanwhile, in the surrounding community, most residents and even those in nearby military bases knew little about this volcano. However, everything changed on June 15th. On that fateful day, the locals and the world witnessed the most powerful eruption of the 20th century. In the early morning of that day, the pressure that had built up beneath Mount Pinatubo for centuries finally released. In one sudden and powerful explosion, the volcano erupted with full force. Instead of rising into the sky as a towering vertical column, the eruption spread outward. It formed a colossal cloud over 10 kilometers. It was so wide that it engulfed the nearby Zambales Mountains. This marked the start of Mount Pinatubo's Plinian eruption. As if one catastrophe weren't enough, the same day brought another blow. Typhoon Yunya, known locally as Diding, swept into the country with winds reaching 145 kilometers per hour. It was as if the forces of nature had conspired to see just how much the nation could endure in a single day. Typhoons aren't something new to the country. As being in the Pacific Ring of Fire, almost 20 typhoons visit the country per year. But what was different was the convergence of a typhoon and an eruption on the same day and the same place. When Mount Pinatubo's climactic eruption struck at 1:42 p.m., the typhoon's eye was just 70 kilometers from the crater. Its counterclockwise winds altered the course of the ashfall. When the typhoon's heavy rains mixed with Pinatubo's volcanic ash, the region was thrown into near-total darkness. It was like the scenes from apocalyptic movies. Strong winds carried the ash as far as 160 kilometers to Manila, forcing the shutdown of almost every airport in the country. The heavy rains triggered massive lahars that poured down the slopes between rivers. These lahars demolished buildings and wiped out every bridge, cutting off vital transportation links. Widespread flooding worsened the disaster as rivers overflowed across Luzon. In Pampanga, the storm swept away at least 170 homes, leaving whole communities in ruins and many families without shelter. At first, it appeared the typhoon only intensified the eruption's impact. The strong wind spread ash far beyond the expected areas, covering thousands of kilometers away. Fine ash traveled as far as the Indian Ocean, and satellites tracked the ash cloud as it circled the globe multiple times. But what if the typhoon was, in some way, a hidden blessing not only for the country, but for the world? This might sound unlikely at first, especially considering that it contributed to the loss of lives. To understand why scientists saw the typhoon as a hidden blessing, we need to look at what could have happened if it hadn't been there during Mount Pinatubo's explosion. The eruption released large amounts of hydrogen chloride gas along with ash and magma. If this gas had reached the stratosphere, it would have reacted with chlorine from man-made chemicals like CFCs and caused significant damage to the ozone layer, which protects the planet from the sun's harmful ultraviolet rays. Fortunately, these worst-case outcomes were avoided because of the typhoon's timing. As the typhoon moved through the eruption's plume, its rains removed most of the hydrogen chloride before it could reach the upper atmosphere and harm the ozone layer. Sunlight includes a variety of light waves, but much of the ultraviolet or UV radiation is blocked by our atmosphere before it reaches the Earth's surface. However, two types of UV rays do make it through. UVA, and UVB. Although UVB makes up only a small fraction of the UV radiation that reaches us, it poses the greatest risk to living organisms. Now, going back to our main question, what would have happened if the ozone layer had significantly thinned due to the eruption of Mount Pinatubo? The straightforward answer is that more UVB radiation would have reached the Earth's surface. High levels of UVB radiation can be very dangerous for people. Research has shown that it is a key cause of skin cancer, including malignant melanoma, the most serious type. It also raises the likelihood of developing cataracts, which can cause blindness. But the impact wouldn't just be on humans. UVB can harm crop yields that could result in food shortages. Higher levels of UVB radiation can harm crops by damaging their cells and interfering with photosynthesis. This reduces how efficiently plants convert sunlight into energy and slows their growth, resulting in less overall plant mass and lower yields. UVB exposure can also weaken plants, making them more vulnerable to diseases and environmental challenges. Together, these effects can reduce crop production and increase the risk of food shortages. But the danger of UVB radiation isn't limited to life on land. It reaches the oceans too. It begins with phytoplankton, the microscopic plants that form the foundation of the entire marine ecosystem. Living on the sunlit surface of the ocean, they would have been the first to face the strong UVB rays if the ozone layer had thinned. Intense UVB can damage their cellular structures, impairing their ability to photosynthesize and reproduce. A decline in their numbers ripples through the marine food chain, starving zooplankton and fish larvae, and eventually impacting top predators like fish, seabirds, and marine mammals. This in turn would put both our food supply and the livelihoods of millions who depend on the ocean at risk. And if you think that's the end of its impact, think again. Phytoplankton also help keep our planet's balance in check. A steep drop in their numbers would disrupt the Earth's carbon cycle. These microscopic life forms serve as potent carbon sponges, removing vast amounts of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. Without them, this essential defense against climate change would crumble, amplifying its already severe impacts. All things considered, if not for Typhoon Yunya, we might still be feeling the scars of Pinatubo's fury even 36 years later. What seemed like a cruel twist of fate in 1991 was, in truth, an unexpected act of salvation. Hence, we can confidently say that a typhoon just saved the day. But what are your thoughts about this? If you'd love to support our channel, please subscribe and hit that join button. As always, until the next one.